everywhere.
My name is Adrian Turner. I'm CEO of Mocana Corporation, and we are a leading device security software vendor. What we're here to talk about today is connected medical devices, some of the security concerns and issues associated with connecting medical devices, as well as some of the countermeasures. In terms of agenda, I'm going to begin by talking about the medical device ecosystem, talk about some attacks and demonstrated vulnerabilities with medical devices, move on to talk about radio interference and the fragility of medical network systems, talk about CE or clinical engineering and IT and some of the cultural issues as those two functions come together. Talk about some of the security countermeasures, government regulations and standards, and then wrap up with a summary. So beginning in talking with the medical ecosystem, about the medical ecosystem, up until now, medical devices have been largely standalone. We've had custom circuit boards and wiring, and those devices have been sitting on networks that have not only predominantly been proprietary networks, but they've also been wired networks. And what we're moving to now is a state where almost all medical devices are CPU and software based. And in addition to that, most devices are network capable, and increasingly they're wireless network capable. They're also increasingly being integrated into a hospital's IT system. And as a consequence, we're seeing this marriage of clinical engineering and IT as these connected devices look more and more like traditional IT systems and connected IT devices. And as a consequence of that, we need to be thinking about these devices as nodes on a network, and we know that a network is only as strong as its weakest link or weakest node. So we need to ensure that these new nodes are properly secured. In addition to that, we have the trend of extending the hospital to patients' homes. When we look at the aging population coupled with the increased cost of care, the number of hospital beds available, it just makes a lot of sense to be able to extend the hospital to the home and to do that through remote patient monitoring, which is going to mean that these devices, connected devices, increasingly in the future, are going to be sitting too outside of a hospital environment. They're going to need to be remotely managed and secured, and in a lot of cases, the communications is going to be traveling across more open networks than has been the case historically. So how many devices are there? From what we can tell, approximately 25 million Americans today have some form of implantable device, whether it's pacemakers, drug pumps, neurostimulators, or defibrillators. In addition to that, there are many more devices inside a hospital context, and that can range from tablets to even cell phones, ventilators, portable x-ray devices, automated medical dispensers, and drug infusers. So let's move and talk about some of the attacks and demonstrated vulnerabilities in these connected systems to date. We really think about it in terms of two levels of threat. The first level of threat relates to the fact that these devices are being connected into systems that the manufacturer didn't necessarily anticipate, particularly when you look at the life cycle of a device, a medical device, which can oftentimes be 5 to 7 years. The environment is changing rapidly that these devices are operating within. The second level of threat relates to the fact that a connected device can form a system of systems, and particularly in the context of automating the collection of data and automating care processes, being able to take advantage or use that data. Oftentimes people may not get involved as a system communicates with another system. And the current FDA regulatory model really regulates the medical device vendors only up until the sale of the device to the customer, but not beyond that, which is increasingly seen as inadequate. So let's drill down and talk about some specific incidents that have taken place in recent years. The first one is in April 2003, where some Russian hackers invaded the ER computers at a hospital in Nevada, where two employees had downloaded a game containing a Trojan horse, and that caused problems for the network and exposed the network. Moving to May 2005, we saw overseas hackers taking over a hospital PBX, making thousands of international calls on the hospital's phone bill. Moving to May 2006, we saw Christopher Maxwell, 19-year-old, who actually was sentenced to prison and fined $252,000 for unleashing a botnet which attacked computers at a hospital in Seattle. And that led to the shutting down of computers in the ICU, jammed doors in operating suites, and disruption of the hospital's paging system. Worth noting that the same advertising botnet that earned him about $100,000 also damaged DoD computers in Germany. So here we've got a situation where you know, a hospital's network was really collateral damage and not necessarily the initial target of an attack. Fast forward to September 2006, and we saw hackers breaking into the Akron Children's Hospital, accessing 230,000 patient records and taking financial information on 12,000 donors. Fast forward to May 2008, and we saw researchers at three American universities demonstrate a radio hack on an implanted defibrillator or pacemaker, where they were able to extract personal information, shut the device down, and deliver shocks at will. So we're seeing physical world consequences for these potential breaches and demonstrated breaches. November 2008, a virus infected three London hospitals that caused patients to have to be diverted to other hospitals. And in April 2009, the Conflica virus infected thousands of MRI machines. But the regulatory requirements mandated that hospitals wait 90 days before applying the patch. And this is an example of, we've got a very fast-moving IT threat landscape coupled with a highly regulated, necessarily so, but a highly regulated medical device ecosystem. And in May 2009, we saw hackers break into the Virginia Department of Health's prescription monitoring program, steal records, and demand a $10 million ransom. The records were backed up and not lost. And then lastly, in July 2009, we saw the first calling of attention to the lack of security mechanisms in proliferating neural implants that help people hear, move prosthetic limbs, and potentially also control computers, and the birth of what's referred to as neurosecurity. So what does this all tell us? What it tells us is that even though there's not a ton of device hacking happening yet, the implications can be really damaging for a single breach. The motives are still centered primarily around profit. There is this false sense of security in the medical device ecosystem, and security measures today are very uncommon in medical devices. And that's surprising to us, given the physical world consequences of breaches and the increasing proliferation of connected devices, as well as the lifespan of these devices in the marketplace. Devices deployed today will probably be in the marketplace 6 or 7 years from now. So it's more important than ever to be thinking about what's the landscape going to look like 5 years from now, and providing as best protection we can today, gold standard protection today. So let me give you two specific examples of medical device systems that were breached. One was a cardiology system, a hemodynamic monitoring or a blood monitoring system that was an NT-based system. And as a consequence of that, there was a Microsoft patch that could address the issue, but the manufacturer actually recommended in this instance not to use the patch. There was some confusion about which patch would actually address the problem. So the recommendation was to disconnect the monitoring device from the lab, from the network. But the problem was the cath lab was remote, so it greatly reduced the utility of that device. The second one was a portable ultrasound example, and here was a device loaned to a hospital, and the loaner had a virus in the device already that propagated throughout the hospital's network. So what I'd like to do is to move to another area of concern around medical devices and securing medical devices, and that's radio interference. And in the context of a medical device and medical device security, we can think of radio interference not unlike denial of service attacks. If the radio interference interferes with the proper functioning and communication of that system. So increasingly wireless devices are being deployed in hospital environments, and there's lots of opportunities for interference, whether it's medical telemetry from workstations, whether it's RFID, readers, cell phones, pages, even television. And it's important for IT and CE functions to inventory and manage frequencies more closely than in other environments because of the implications. That has an impact on security, signal quality, and also bandwidth allocation. Next, I want to talk about CE versus IT, clinical engineering versus IT. And the fundamental difference here in terms of where these groups are coming from is that IT thinks about mission-critical systems, and it can be expensive in terms of dollars for IT systems to go down. But CE thinks in the context of life-critical systems. So if a system goes down, a patient potentially can't be monitored or send alarms, and there can be physical consequences for that. So these worlds are very different. The DNA of these groups are very different. And for the first time, they're really having to work closely together. And it's necessary that they do, as these medical devices look more and more like IT systems. So what can be done? We've talked about increasing number of devices. We've talked about some specific cases of threats. We've talked about this cultural change that has to happen between CE and IT. What I want to talk about next is some specific countermeasures to protecting these systems. First one is boot and update verification. So ensuring that code and patches are digitally signed, and that needs to be more common. It's common on workstations, but today it's not common with other types of medical devices. And there needs to be the strong use of cryptography to validate the BIOS firmware and bootloader images. The second countermeasure is device backup. So workstations are backed up today, but devices today on the whole, their information is not backed up. So if a system goes down, it's going to be restored with potentially data or software that doesn't include the latest patches and fixes, or at least there's a risk of that. Next countermeasure is ensuring network layer encryption for IP addressable devices using protocols like IPsec that are widely deployed in IT infrastructure today. Not as common in medical devices today because of perceived complexity and provisioning, which is not necessarily true. And then also, as we're seeing 802.15.14 emerge as a way to implement IPv6 on low power devices, it's going to be important to ensure that those systems are properly connected at the network layer as well. At the link layer, it's important to use established IT standards like WPA2 for 802.11 networks, as opposed to, for example, WEP, which is inadequate. At the application level, we advocate the use of things like secure shell, which is useful for encrypting communications between hosts over an unsecured network, for tunneling, port forwarding, securing file transfers using the SFTP protocol. And this also supports key exchange and user authentication. Another application layer security countermeasure that's important is SSL or TLS, which is widely used on the web today. And also, it's increasingly being used DTLS in voice over IP environments as well. And it supports peer negotiation for algorithm selection, public key-based exchange of secret session keys and certificates. But I should note that today, SSL or TLS is primarily used between the sync or the base station and the rest of the enterprise network, but not within the network of smart objects themselves. Anti-malware agents, so today's signature-based model that's widely deployed for antivirus on PCs simply doesn't make sense on medical devices. They don't protect against zero-day attacks. There's concerns about the database size, impact on battery life, and the frequency with which signatures are updated. So a better approach is a non-signature-based approach where you scan the code and you ensure that the code behaves and acts exactly as it's intended to. And if there's a deviation from that behavior, you know that there's arbitrary code being executed on the device. And other benefits of this approach is that it's easy to integrate. It requires no code changes to the base code. There's minimal CPU usage and no false positives. The other countermeasure is proximity. So providing an additional layer of protection that if a device is collecting data from a medical, particularly an implantable device, that there'd be some rules about how close that device should be to the implantable device. And there's some work being done in that domain in the French National Institute for Research in Computer Science and Control. And the other one is demanding an MDS or a manufacturer's disclosure statement for medical device security. So very quickly, I want to touch on some of the standards that being formed around medical device security. IEC 8001 is an example. Right now, it's only in draft stage and deals with application of risk management best practices to enterprise networks. Another one is HIPAA, but the problem with HIPAA is that it really hasn't been enforced, and there's really not a strong onus on manufacturers to step up and secure their devices the right way. The other one is the high-tech portion of the 2009 Recovery Act, which really has some teeth to it. Relates to e-health records and protection of medical data. So to summarize, what we see is medical devices increasingly proliferating in connecting to networks, the number of them proliferating. We see IT and clinical engineering having to work together. There's some culture shock here, but it has to be overcome. The challenge is neither of them are really security experts today. Hospitals hold on to medical devices for a lot longer than other classes of devices like consumer electronics. So if the lifespan is 6 or 7 years, I mean, even up over 10 years, we need to take extra steps today to secure those systems. And lastly, manufacturers need to design security in from the start. Medical device manufacturers need to be responsible and accountable for taking steps today. Basic encryption and authentication is a good start, as is boot verification and code signing. And the reality is that devices feed information to and pull information from electronic health records. And whilst there's been fragmentation about how these devices and ways that these devices connect in the past, there's really this coalescing around 802.11x and Bluetooth. So the number of devices is going to increase rapidly. So with that, I want to thank you very much for your time. And if you have any follow-up questions, please don't hesitate to contact me. My email address is listed on the slide, and my phone number is as well. And lastly, I'd like to thank ECRI and Jim Keller for the assistance and access to source materials for the presentation. Thank you.